If you hang a hummingbird feeder, they will come, especially if you live near one of the ruby-throated hummingbird's preferred habitats, mixed deciduous forests, open fields, or riverbanks. Hummingbird feeders have expanded the habitat and perhaps even the range of these birds by providing a dependable source of food that makes up 2/3 of their calorie consumption. So rather than a shrinking habitat due to human incursion, hummingbird habitat is expanding into suburban environs and beyond, although deforestation is an ongoing threat. But just because you put up a hummingbird feeder doesn't mean you will get an unimpeded look. Hummingbirds are naturally curious, but shy in the presence of humans. They often settle behind a feeder or at the point furthest from human sight. So to get closer views, our cameraman sets up inside a hunter's blind, close to the action. So with that advantage, let's take a closer look at our birds. The female ruby-throated is an iridescent green with white chest and facial feathering. She appears slightly more elongated and more elegant than the male. She is up to 25% larger than the male, has rounded dark tail feathering with white tips on the outer three feathers on each side. The male is smaller and darker than the female. His chest is gray rather than white. He sports a ruby gorget or throat patch that varies in color with the angle of light, from almost black to brilliant crimson or even golden. The male has pointed tail feathers arranged in a forked pattern. He lacks white tips on his tail feathering. The ruby-throated hummingbird varies in size from 2.8 to 3.5 inches and weighs between 1 2/10 of an ounce. In flight, males beat their wings around 70 beats a second, females slightly slower at 53 beats. Notice the male's tiny feet. Hummingbirds cannot walk or hop, but use their feet for grasping branches, or in this case, the feeder. They can scoot sideways while perched with a little help from their wings. From banding studies, ornithologists estimate a hummingbird's lifespan to be 5 to 9 years. Females live longer, with males averaging about 5 years. Here we get a glimpse of the white tips of the tail feathers of our female. This male gives us a better look at the brilliant crimson iridescence of his gorget. Juveniles resemble females until the males reach their first winter and develop a gorget. Male juveniles often have darker striping on the chin and may even have a dark throat feather or two, as we see with these two juveniles sharing a drink at the feeder. A group of hummingbirds is referred to as a charm, which is befitting these charming birds. This male perches on a ring above a backyard feeder. From there, he can watch for intruders. He drives away interlopers with missile-like attacks. Males arrive a week or two before females to establish feeding and mating territories. Once established, he will defend his realm fearlessly and tirelessly. Notice his tongue, which extends nearly half the length of his bill. Notice the constant head movements as he surveys his territory. This male rubs his bill against the ring as if sharpening it. He may be doing this to wear down tiny corrugations along its length. Hummingbirds preen their feathers with both their bills and feet. Our male shows off his forked tail and the gray feathering of his chest. He shows us his backside, more squat and shorter than the female. Rain doesn't impede the hummingbird's feeding or territorial behavior. This male perches on a support structure at the feeder he controls. Note his size against the screw holes in the feeder holder and the tiny black feet displayed here against the white rod. The Pueblo Indians of the American Southwest used feathers in dances to bring rain. The story goes that hummingbirds gathered clouds from the four directions during a great fire to save their land. The brilliant coloring on the hummingbird's throat is said to have come from passing so often through rainbows in search of rain clouds. In another legend, a hummingbird acted like Noah's dove, bringing back a flower as proof the great flood was subsiding. To get a more natural look at our hummers, it's necessary to view them feeding in more natural habitat, such as this backyard trumpet vine. It's clear hummingbirds do not know the word cooperation. Competition is their default setting. Years of evolution have etched this behavior into their DNA, and no amount of surplus, as with our bottomless backyard feeders, alters their behavior. Males compete with males compete with females, and females compete with other females. This female has discovered the blind. She hovers outside its window to make her inspection. Hummingbirds are naturally curious. I've hidden a feeder inside the trumpet vine to focus their attention on natural food sources. This juvenile male has quickly found my hidden food source. For the moment, he can drink at the feeder without competition. Ruby throats lap nectar with grooves on its tongue at a rate of 13 times per second. Most natural hummingbird feeding occurs hovering just above the blossom while thrusting their long bills into the flower to get at the nectar. Hummingbirds lap nectar with their tongues, much like cats lap milk. Since hummingbirds are only found in the Western Hemisphere, they are absent from the traditional fairy tales, legends, and myths of Europe and Africa. There is, however, a rich supply of stories about these tiny birds in Native American mythology. One Mayan legend says the first two hummingbirds were created from small feather scraps left over from the creation of other birds. The god who made the hummers was so pleased, he had an elaborate wedding ceremony for them. Butterflies marked out the bridal suite. Flower petals spread on the ground to make a carpet. Spiders spun webs to make a bridal pathway. And the sun sent down rays, which caused the tiny groom to glow with dazzling reds and greens. The wedding guests noticed that whenever the bridegroom turned away from the sun, he became drab again, like the original gray feathers from which he was made. This female demonstrates an alternative feeding technique by clasping the flower with its tiny feet and swinging itself up into the flower's cone to feed. This method saves some of the energy hovering requires. Because of their enormous energy use, hummingbirds take in several times their weight in calories each day. This feeding method reduces wing noise and may partially hide her from competitors. She even rests for a moment or two inside the flower's cone. Still, she keeps a close lookout, ever wary of attack. There is a legend from a Native American tribe in Puerto Rico about a young woman and a young man who were from rival tribes. Like Romeo and Juliet, they fell in love, precipitating intense criticism from their family and friends. The two found a way to escape both time and culture. One became a hummingbird and the other a red flower. They believe the hummingbird is a sacred pollinator, whose mission is to bring an abundance of new life. Watch as this juvenile finds another food source while sitting atop this trumpet vine. Did you see it? Let's go back and see if we can slow down the action. Hummingbirds are insectivores. They snatch bugs so quickly, the behavior is often overlooked. While hummingbirds get 2/3 of their calories from nectar that supplies the sugar and carbohydrates they need for quick energy, they get the remaining 1/3 from insects, a good source of the fats and proteins needed to build, maintain, and replace bone, muscle cells, and feathers. This youngster is probing the flower base, perhaps for insects, but there could be nectar there as well. He playfully uses the tip of the flower's pollen-receptive stigma for a little target practice. This juvenile ruby throat rests on a branch inside a jumble of trumpet vine, giving us a chance to note the characteristics that identify him as a young male. The most obvious is the faint striping along his throat that will become the brilliant red gorget from which he gets his name. Another feature is the darker gray coloring on the breast. Hummingbirds can fly at speeds of up to 50 miles an hour, more when traveling with the wind, speeds necessary to accomplish its long migration across the Gulf Coast to Mexico and Central America, as far south as Costa Rica. At rest, hummingbirds' hearts beat around 250 times a minute. With exertion, it varies from 600 to 1,200 beats a minute, compared with 200 beats per minute for the average bird. As this juvenile demonstrates, hummingbirds can use their tiny feet for scratching. This one scratches just a little too vigorously, and oops, slips from his perch. Of course, hummingbirds get nectar from other flowers, such as these petunias we've potted on the back porch. Recent scientific studies have shown that small-bodied animals with fast metabolic rates, such as hummingbirds, perceive more information in a unit of time than we do, meaning they experience action more slowly than large-bodied animals with slower metabolisms. They literally observe motion on a finer time scale than our eyes are able to, like a slow motion camera that captures more frames per second to slow down the action. This slowed time perception translates into faster reaction times than humans can follow, which is why hummingbird flight and behavior pass too quickly for our eyes to register. Of course, other nectar feeders make use of the same flowers and shrubs hummingbirds do, such as this butterfly. The hummingbirds don't seem to regard them as competitors. This eastern tiger swallowtail is all over this white butterfly bush, which hummingbirds also love. This hummingbird hawk moth, sipping nectar from that same butterfly bush, is sometimes mistaken for a hummingbird. It hovers like one, but a closer look shows it has no bill and uses a proboscis to suck nectar, while the ruby throat laps nectar with grooves on its tongue at a rate of 13 times per second. Ruby throats have a voice, although they do not sing. Squeaks, twitters, and grating noises are used in a variety of situations, such as when a hummingbird discovers an intruder in its territory. This juvenile seems to have found a restful perch Nevertheless, he constantly looks around to see what competitors might be nearby, while keeping a close lookout for insects. In Cherokee's story, a woman is courted by both a hummingbird and a crane. She first chooses the hummingbird for his good looks, but the crane convinces her that there should be a race around the world, with the winner having her hand in marriage. She agrees, thinking the hummingbird is bound to win because he flies so fast. What she fails to take into account is that crane can fly all night long, while hummingbird is able to fly only during the day. The crane wins, but she reneges on her promise because he is so ugly. Hummingbirds are very aggressive animals. They frequently strafe one another, engage in aerial dogfights, and dive bomb competitors or rivals with abandon. They continually chase each other away from a food source, to the point where one wonders where they find time to feed. Here, a hummingbird uses a U-shaped flight pattern to drive away his competitor. In different circumstances, this same pattern might be an aerial mating display, but here it's clearly aggressive. All hummingbirds are territorial. Females protect nesting sites. Males dominate feeding territories. And juveniles quickly learn to mimic their elders. The most commonly observed courtship display involves a female sitting still, sometimes on a low branch or on the ground, while a male flies in a pendulum arc pattern in front of her. The center of the flight pattern is the lowest point near the ground. The two sides of the pendulum may rise anywhere from 3 to 40 feet. As in this case, our juvenile is performing this display with another juvenile as an act of aggression or dominance. Although with hummingbirds, it can be hard to tell if it's mating behavior or aggression. Another display consists of the vertical flight, up and down, of two hummingbirds, male or female, facing each other, accompanied by twittering sounds. Sometimes they do make contact, although hummingbirds have been known to harm or even kill another bird. It isn't common. But you wouldn't know that from these near misses. Clearly, the aggressor is trying to clip the other and drive him away from the vine. Listen for the smack of contact that drives the competitor away. And that was clearly a direct strike. Here, two hummers have each other up against the ropes, like two aerial boxers looking for an opening. This female feeds for a moment in peace, showing us her sleek, iridescent green feathering and rounded white tail feathering. As it is late summer, it's difficult to distinguish adult females from male juveniles, as both have rounded tail feathers with white tips on the end of its tail. It's the throat markings that give sex away at this stage. Next spring, however, all the males will return from Central America with full gorgets, as well as forked and pointed dark tail feathers. Ruby-throated hummingbirds are the only hummingbirds in the eastern U.S., although there have been some reports of rufous hummingbirds in the area. It's too early to know if these are incidental sightings or evidence of a new migration pattern for that typically West Coast species. Before leaving our ruby-throated hummingbirds, let's take another look at a female, arching her back to feed in the classic hovering position.